And it makes sense. Because he is the one that has no beginning, and he is the one that has no end. And the one that has a beginning and the one that has an end should be a servant to him, because he's the master. That's what we call him, right? We say, oh, master. Oh, king. King of kings. Lord of the worlds. We call on him with the most grandiose, most magnificent terminologies. Even the Christians, they say that when Jesus was placed on the cross to show his weakness and his humility and obeisance and love and devotion, knowing that there was someone higher than him and that he couldn't even help himself, the Bible even says that they say Jesus said, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? My God, why hast thou forsaken me? That's what the Bible says. Showing that there's one who can't be put on that cross. Showing that there's one who's not subject to time or space or disease or ailments or calamities or misfortunes or stress or depressed like a human being is subject to. So we're here today to tell you about the truth of Islam. That all of those other versions of Islam are not the real Islam. And that the real religion of Jesus is not what's being depicted and represented today. It's not the real religion of Jesus, the Christ, born of the Immaculate Conception. But rather, it is a religion that teaches man to believe in one God, alone with no partners, no associates, no father, no son, no uncles, no aunts, no mother. He's alone. He has no partners whatsoever. And that he is the only one that should be worshipped. And he's the only one that your devotion should be given directly to. Only to him alone. We like to end this discussion with you, or this talk, with the statement of not Allah and not the Prophet Muhammad, nor from any Muslim scholar or any of the Muslims that are sitting here. I'm going to leave you with the statement of a person that has deceased. He's deceased now. He died a few years ago. When I was traveling one day, I want you to think about these statements. And you young guys, you probably don't know about this person. The older guys in their 30s, 40s, they remember him very, very clearly. I was traveling one day to go to talk about Islam. I was in the airport. I saw Time magazine. This must have been about 7 years ago or more. It was an article talking about the disease that the famous black or African-American comedian had contracted, and his name is Richard Pryor. I leave you with the statements of Richard Pryor for you to think. He said, and because he was a comedian, he's making fun, he's making jokes. He said, I had a dream that I was in front of a cross. And as I got closer to that cross, I saw the Lord. This is what he said. I saw the Lord, Jesus. He said, and Jesus said to me, come closer, Richard. He said, in my dream, I went closer to the cross. He said, no, come closer, come closer. So he said, I got closer and closer, right up in front of Jesus on the cross. He said, and then he said to me, Richard, can you help me down from here? I don't take that as a joke, even though some of you may think it's to be funny. He said that Jesus said to him, Richard, can you help me down from here? But when you think about that statement of Richard Pryor, that shows you for at least one point of his life, he used that brain that my mother told me I should use. Because if that person had any divinity or holiness inside of him, a smidgen of divinity or holiness, inside of him, he wouldn't have been on the cross at all, because he could have helped himself. Because if he's the Son of God, he could have helped himself. He wouldn't need any help whatsoever. And that's exactly what Islam says. That you should single out God and worship him by himself. And don't make him a partner or anything, a partner with him. When you worship him, when you pray to him alone. When you fast, fast on his behalf alone. When you give charity to people, give it in his name and no one else's name, alone. When you enjoin in the good and forbidding the evil, do it in his name and for him alone. When you take care of your family, do it in his name alone. Don't associate Moses with him, nor Abraham with him, nor Muhammad with him, nor Jesus with him, nor any tree or any angel, or the moon or the sun. Don't call on anyone to get to him, nor call on him through anyone else. Saint Christopher, Saint Luke, Vishnu, Krishna. Don't call on anyone, Buddha. Call on him alone, and he'll guide you to the truth of Islam. He'll guide you to the true religion of Jesus and Moses and Abraham and all the prophets. This is what we wanted to bring to you today. If you have any questions whatsoever, you can present them now. Don't be ashamed. Don't be shy. Anything you want to ask. And if we don't know the answer, then we can get your telephone number or your email address. We can contact you and get you the answer from the scholars who know much more than we do. This is only a humble effort from these brothers and sisters here in this mosque and your brother who is formerly from Newark, as I mentioned, who used to teach in that church, in the basement of that church across the street, who was blessed by the Lord of the worlds to come to the reality of the truth of Islam. I ask Allah, the one and true and living God, to guide you all to the truth of Islam, so that you'll be able to stand in front of him with a pure, clean heart. May Allah guide you. The questions are here. We can put, and I don't mean in a bad sense, we can put Islam to the side. My grandfather, Moses Gray, who's now dead for some years now, my mother's father, used to be a deacon in that church across the street where I used to teach. He was a deacon in that church. And the way he understood Christianity, we put Islam on the side, the way he understood Christianity was that there's no boyfriend and girlfriend in Christianity. From what he read in the Bible, that you have to get married. He used to say to me, if you want to drink the milk, you have to buy the cow. That's what he used to say to me. Meaning, you want that girl, you should marry her. You shouldn't just sleep with her. He said, because animals jump from one female animal to another. You see it right now in the streets. You see, after, you know, early in the morning, you coming from hanging out all night, you know, 4 o'clock in the morning, you see dogs, 5, 6, 7, 8 male dogs following that one female dog. One jumps on, the other one jumps off, another one jumps on, that one jumps off, another one jumps on, another one jumps off. This is not the way of a dignified human being. And this is not the way that God intended it. This is not the way he intended it. My grandfather and grandmother, and they didn't know, and I believed them, because my grandfather, as a Christian, was a very honest, trustworthy man. A very honest, trustworthy man with dignity and respect for all living things. He never had a woman other than my grandmother. They were married until they died, about 62 years. My grandmother never had another man, and my grandfather never had another woman. They got married around 16 and 18 years of age. So in Christianity, there's no boyfriend and girlfriend. In fact, my grandfather could not approach my grandmother directly. He had to go and ask for her father's permission to get her hand in marriage. That's in Christianity. And my father, who's now deceased, when he came from Alabama and came to 20, 2:18, or excuse me, 2:12.